All right. Good morning. Thank you for joining us for this webcast and technical transfer meeting on biological filtration. And this is being brought to you by the Water Research Foundation, as well as hosted by the Birmingham Waterworks Board. And we're really excited to do this. It's the first time we've done this with the foundation, and we've got a great panel of speakers. I am John Albear. I'm with the foundation. I'll be moderating this webcast. And it's also part of a tech transfer here in Birmingham, Alabama. So we do have a live audience here, as well as quite a large webcast audience. So we're really pleased about the outcome. The webcast and technical transfer meeting will cover the use of biological filtration and focus on the engineering and operation of such filters from a national perspective. This tech transfer and webcast will also highlight local research done here at Birmingham on this technology. Just a few administrative items before we begin. To introduce Dr. Huck, he has been a professor and chairholder in the Water Treatment Department of the Civil and Environmental Engineering at the University of Waterloo. He has had funding provided by 17 partners from the water industry. In 2003, Dr. Huck was awarded a university research chair and has been instrumental in developing research collaboration between the drinking water industry and the universities in Ontario. Dr. Huck received his bachelor's and master's degrees in civil and water resources engineering at the University of Waterloo. His PhD was obtained from McMaster University in Hamilton, Ontario, in chemical engineering. Following 2 years in consulting, Dr. Huck joined the University of Regina and moved to the University of Alberta in 1982. Dr. Huck has more than 100 refereed publications and has won several awards, including the George Warren Fuller Award and the AP Black Research Award. With that, I'll turn the talk over to Dr. Huck.
Well, thank you very much, John, for the kind introduction, and I am delighted to be able to participate. I'm actually participating from Berlin, Germany, where I'm working with Professor Yackel at the moment on some new applications of biological filtration. So to begin the presentation, just to give you an idea of the things that we'll be talking about, I will provide some context, and then some basics regarding biofiltration, a little bit on the history, some discussion of the factors that are important for performance, because I think we do want to focus on the engineering and practical aspects today, and then discuss some applications of biological filtration. So I think before we start talking about biological filtration itself, it's probably useful to step back and think about water treatment in general. And what are some of the goals that treatment has to meet? And obviously, an individual water supply may not have to meet all of these goals because it may already do so, but in a comprehensive situation, and particularly for surface waters, obviously particle and turbidity removal is very important. In some cases, removal of TOC. Obviously, disinfection or inactivation of pathogens. Removal of chemical contaminants where those are present above guideline or regulatory limits. We also want to maximize the biological stability of the water for the distribution system as well as its chemical stability. And we want to make sure that we maintain the quality as it leaves the treatment plant right to the consumer's tap, and including, of course, the important aesthetic aspects of taste and odor. And it's possible to, in a very general sense, think about where these goals might be met within a typical treatment train. And on the horizontal axis of this slide is shown the usual location in the treatment train. And on the vertical axis is the number of processes that would normally be used. So as we can see, there are several processes that would contribute to particle removal. Whereas there's usually only one process that would be contributing to disinfection, And I've added also as the last step, maintaining a residual for the distribution system. If we look now at biological filtration, we can see that actually biological filtration can contribute to a number of these treatment goals, and I want to cover several of them today. So that in addition to improving the biological stability of the water, it can contribute to TOC reduction, potentially to removal of chemical contaminants and taste and odor, and when it's functioning as a filter, of course, it can contribute to particle removal. The next slide shows a quote from a German professor that I first met probably 20 or more years ago, and he made the statement in German, of course, but this is the English version, that his approach to water treatment would be as much chemistry as necessary and as much biology as possible. And I think that approach is something that remains true probably even more today than when it was first articulated some time ago. Well, in terms of introducing biological treatment, many of you may be familiar with this, but if we think of a biofilter, it looks pretty much like a normal filter, but if we go in closer and look at a few particles, we can see that on the media particles, there is some what's called a biofilm growing, or a layer of bacteria and their extra polymeric substances. And then there may also be some free bacteria that are floating within the among the media, but most of the biological activity actually occurs on the surface of the media. And there are various biological processes that go on in a biological filter, and they're listed on this slide. And what are some of the applications of biological processes? Well, probably the most common is the removal of what's called biodegradable organic matter, or BOM, and this can be for the purpose of biological stability of the water in the distribution system, and also for the removal of DBP precursors. And probably the biological stability aspect has been more stressed in Europe than it has been historically in North American practice, because in North America we typically rely on a disinfectant residual in the distribution system to assist in maintaining water quality, whereas that's less of a practice, particularly in Western Europe. Biological processes can also carry out nitrification, denitrification, and iron and manganese removal, but we're not going to talk about those today because of time limitations. And it's also been shown recently that that biological processes can achieve some removal of trace contaminants, including taste and odor compounds like geosmin and MIB, and in some cases, some of the pharmaceuticals and endocrine disrupting compounds. And also, it's been relatively recently demonstrated by us, among others, that biological filtration can be very effective as a membrane pretreatment to reduce fouling. In terms of the historical development of biological filtration, of course, probably the original biological process was slow sand filtration, and then also bank filtration, which is in use both in North America and in Europe, and also passage of the water through the ground. Probably beginning in the 1970s, certainly in the 1980s, then rapid biofiltration began to be used, starting initially in European waterworks and with later introduction in North America. I'm not going to talk about bank and slow sand filtration today, again, for reasons of time, but both have been the subject of various previous AWAR studies, and those reports would be available. So as I indicated, rapid biofiltration started in Europe in the 1970s and 1980s, and its introduction was related to the switch away from chlorine to ozone for disinfection. And the ozone was sometimes installed in existing plants following the filtration step that was already there, and it was found in order to control bacterial regrowth in the distribution system that they wanted to have a second filtration step. And so therefore they did install second stage filters, and these were often GAC filters, And this is the origin of the term the biological activated carbon, or BAC process. But as we'll see, you don't have to have activated carbon as the media in order to have biological filtration. And in fact, in North American practice, biological filtration has often been introduced in plants having a single filtration step. And so this is a case then of a particular filter having to do both removal of biodegradable organic matter and removal of particulate matter. And there have been some earlier questions as to whether these were conflicting requirements, and it really seems that they probably aren't. So in the presentation today from here on, I'm going to focus on single-stage biological filtration for the removal of biodegradable organic matter in general and organic trace contaminants and organic membrane foulants very briefly at the end. So some basic aspects of biological processes. The bacteria that are involved are what are called heterotrophic bacteria, which means that they use organic carbon as a food source. Obviously, we have to have non-toxic conditions in order for them to exist on the filters, but that's usually not a problem in drinking water. And they exist as a thin film on the media, which is referred to as a biofilm. And this is visible under a microscope, and it might be on the order of about 50 microns thick, or 0.05 millimeters. And if we kind of keep in mind that a typical effective size for sand media might be half a millimeter, we can see that that biofilm is really quite small, and so you typically can't see it with the naked eye. So it's quite different than biological processes in wastewater where, you know, we can see slimes and so on. And in these biological processes, organic carbon has traditionally been considered the limiting nutrient, and so the processes are designed really to remove that. There's some evidence for some types of water that phosphorus may be limiting, but that's a more specialized situation. And in fact, in drinking water biofiltration, this biofilm doesn't necessarily cover the whole media, but it may exist as a patchy type of biofilm. And basically, it's going to happen in a filter whenever a disinfectant residual, such as chlorine, is absent from the filter. The reason that it happens in the filter is that there's a very large surface area within the filter, if you think of the surface area of all those media grains. And so it will happen whether you want it or not if you don't have a disinfectant residual. And the question is, how can we best take advantage of that? Biological activity and biofilm growth can be enhanced by ozonation because this converts some of the organic matter into more easily biodegradable organic matter. And there are different ways of measuring this organic matter, and I'll mention them, some of the more common ones just briefly today. The so-called assimilable organic carbon method, which was originally developed in the Netherlands, the biodegradable dissolved organic carbon method. In some cases, some specific compounds, particularly biodegradable ozonation byproducts, such as aldehydes, and there are also some other methods that are available. Of course, the amount of biomass that's present is important, and there are methods to measure those, which are listed here on the slide. But they all have their limitations. And research has shown, in fact, some that we've completed for WRF, that the removals of biodegradable organic carbon are qualitatively related to the amount of biomass, but not directly quantitatively related to it. Another good thing is that this biomass, because it's such a thin layer, it doesn't typically interfere with filter operation in the traditional sense for particle removal and keeping the bed clean and so on, as long as the backwashing is appropriately done. Now, here are some results from a previous AWARF study that lists some of the major parameters that influence rapid biological filtration, and both the degree of control that we have over them, indicated by a check mark, and also the effect, indicated by a diamond. And just as an example, we see that the media type has perhaps a moderate effect on the process, but we have a very high degree of control over it because we can choose the media. Whereas if we look down towards the bottom of the figure, the temperature, we essentially have no control over, and yet it has a very high impact on the process. One of the issues for drinking water biofiltration design is that there are as yet no readily accepted design criteria. There's nothing like CT tables for biofiltration. So one of the tasks over the next few years is to try to develop design approaches that can be applied to biological filtration. Well, coming back also to this AWARF study that I mentioned, and one of the things about this study was that it was conducted both with full-scale and demonstration-scale facilities. It was co-directed by myself and Brad Coffey at MWD in California. And so in contrast to a number of studies that have been conducted at pilot scale, this was essentially full-scale information. And what we saw was that the removals of BOM increased with increasing contact time, but in a less than proportional way. And you may see this term EBCT, which stands for empty bed contact time. And that's often used in connection with biological filtration. It's sort of a carryover from the original BAC, or activated carbon process, because that's, of course, a common parameter in activated carbon applications. But the EBCT, or the contact time that is necessary in biological filtration, is depending on what our objectives are. And in general, it's probably going to be longer for effective removal of DBP precursors than for the removal of easily biodegradable ozonation byproducts such as aldehydes. Another interesting result from the study was that GAC as a media was only measurably better than anthracite at really quite low temperatures. And the difference between the two depended on the parameter that we were measuring. And this was so despite the fact that the biomass was actually higher on the GAC. A couple of additional results from this study was that the amount of biomass loss due to regular backwashing in the filter did not have an impact on performance. And interestingly enough, chlorine in the backwash water had at most a modest effect at full scale. So this result may be different in different locations, and it really depends on the extent to which the chlorine residual in the backwash water will penetrate to the top of the bed or be consumed on its way as the water goes up the bed. The other encouraging thing from this study was that the biological aspect of the filters was not really more sensitive than the particle removal aspect. So if we operated the filters for good particle removal in terms of things like backwashing and so on, then the biology would be just fine with that. A couple of words quickly on modeling of biofiltration. There have been various models developed over the years, but most of these are what could be called research models, so they're not really applicable for practice. And a major practical objective of any monitoring, or any modeling rather, is what's the required filter depth or contact time that we need for a particular application. And I'll come back to this at the end of the presentation. Just to look in a very general sense about removals of biodegradable carbon as a function of depth in a filter. So across the top of the figure, we have the concentration and the depth as a ratio of the initial, so kind of the remaining percent concentration. The red line shows a typical behavior pattern for the removal of, let's say, AOC or aldehydes as a function of filter depth. And really, depending on what our target effluent concentration is, which is shown by the vertical blue line, then where that target concentration crosses the concentration profile, then this gives us the required depth or contact time that we're going to need for the filter. And we can see that it's not a linear relationship, so it's a case of decreasing returns. Doubling the depth of the filter will not give us usually double the removals. It'll be less than double. Now turning to some specific applications, some work done by one of my PhD students, Sarah El-Hadi, several years ago that was published in the journal, looking at the removal of geosmin and MIB by biological filtration. And this slide shows the laboratory scale columns that she used. They're insulated, of course, here in the slide, and they were 2-inch diameter glass columns. And the next slide shows just some sample results. So this was the percent removal of the spiked concentrations of geosmin as a function of time during some steady state behavior. And basically, she was operating two types of filters, GAC and anthracite, at two temperatures, 8 and 20 degrees C. And in some cases, she was ramping up the concentration of the geosmin being fed, in some cases not. But I think what's really important here from the slide, and these were kind of normal operating conditions, about 5 minutes EVCT and maybe 5 or 7 meters per hour in terms of a filtration rate, which is about 10 or 5 meters per hour, I think is, no, that's 2 gallons per minute per square foot. Anyway, what we can see is that the GAC in this case was measurably better. The anthracite, even at the high temperature, was not so good, and neither really performed well at the same at the lower temperature. But the removals were not complete. So one of the things that this says is that biological filtration can probably contribute to removal of taste and odor, but it won't necessarily solve the problem all by itself. Some more recent results in the next few slides, looking at the removal of some pharmaceutically active compounds and endocrine disruptors by biofiltration. And we were actually looking at biofiltration at pilot scale as a membrane pretreatment, but we did some spiking of some of these trace contaminants as well. And the experimental approach was we took water from our local river, the Grand River, which is a reasonably impacted source, both municipally and agriculturally. We passed it through a roughing filter of coarse media because of the turbidity spikes that occur in the river, and then through biofiltration, and then finally onto ultrafiltration membranes. And the biofilters, in fact, we looked at two biofilters in parallel. They were dual media filters, so standard filter media design. One had an EBCT of 5 minutes and the other had 14 minutes. Operated in downflow mode at 5 meters per hour or 2 gallons per minute per square foot, and backwashed with air scour once a week. And interestingly, we didn't add any coagulant prior to this filtration. And this is the membrane setup. It was a Z-weed unit, and we operated that at a temperature-adjusted flux of 60 LMH for 20 degrees C. And just to very briefly summarize the results, we spiked two concentrations of the pharmaceuticals. 500 nanograms per liter was the lower concentration, and we spiked that concentration for a number of weeks, and we repeated that at various times over the year, and we have quite substantial temperature variations down essentially to freezing in the winter. And we got the best removals for ibuprofen. We got some removals that were variable for DEET and naproxen, and no removals for atrazine and carbamazepine. So just a taste to show you that we can get some removals with biological filtration, but it's going to depend on the compound. And in terms of the reduction in funneling with the ultrafiltration membranes, what we were able to show was that using biofiltration could substantially reduce fouling and that the longer contact time was beneficial. And we think that this may be a niche for small systems where this would be a very simple membrane pretreatment to operate. Well, what about a practically oriented design parameter that I alluded to before? What we've done in some other work has been to define a new parameter, which we've called the biofiltration factor. And we then defined this as being 0.5 for a situation where we get 50% removal of AOC, or easily biodegradable carbon, at approximately room temperature 20 degrees C. So this is just a definition for convenience, 0.5 at 50% removal. That's kind of easy to remember. And probably the next task is then we're going to have to do work to define what biofiltration factors would need to be for other applications and other degrees of removal and develop some design tables that we could hopefully use. And we would hope that then that this biofiltration factor could be the biofiltration equivalent of G for flocculation or CT for disinfection or L over D for particle removal filtration. So in other words, they're good engineering parameters. They don't necessarily capture all of the subtleties of a process, but they're very useful in practice. Well, let's come back and just before we finish up, review then some of the important design and operating factors for biological filtration, for rapid biological filtration. And I've divided them here into three categories. The ones that are readily controllable, the type and the size of the media, the bed depth, and the type of backwashing that we do. The ones that that may have just as much impact but are less controllable are the loading of biodegradable organic matter onto the filter, and also whether or not we have chlorine in the backwash water. And I put that in brackets because in a new plant, if we want to avoid having chlorine in the backwash water, we can design it to do that. But if we're in a retrofit situation, that's not always possible. And, of course, the uncontrollable but very important factor is temperature. So, to summarize, rapid biofiltration has been in use in water treatment practice for at least several decades. It's going to occur in any normal filter when a disinfectant residual is not present. The primary application, and the one I focused on today, is the removal of biodegradable organic carbon. And within this objective or application, there are what I call the classical objectives and some newer ones. And the classical ones are the reduction in easily biodegradable carbon, such as AOC, to control regrowth in the distribution system, especially important if ozonation is in the process, and also the reduction of DBP formation potential. Some of the newer objectives, taste and odor removal, removal of some trace contaminants, such as pharmaceuticals, depending on their biodegradability, and as a membrane pretreatment. And in fact, there is a large utility near Toronto, the region of Peel, that is using biological filtration at full scale as a membrane pretreatment. They do, in fact, have ozone prior to their biological filters. Anyway, to finish off with the summary, some of the important factors that we need to worry about as engineers are controllable, some are not. AWARF, as was indicated earlier by John, has invested really quite a bit in biological filtration. There's lots of good information available. We still need general design and operating parameters, and I'm proposing that the biofiltration factor is something that can offer potential in this regard. So the next slide shows some of the people that I'd like to thank for contributions.